right, Christ Community Church, welcome to the small group launch. My name's Garrett. You've probably seen me around. If you haven't, I'd love to meet you on one of the Sundays. I'm sitting here with Pastor David, the man himself, and we just finished the first week of our series on the Creed, and we're trying something new. We're going to do these small group launch videos, just kind of trying to create a platform to launch a deeper discussion, kind of have a deeper dive into the topics that we are we're going to be talking about as we dive into one of the oldest of Christian traditions outside of like the Bible, the Apostles' Creed. So, Pastor David, first week is I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. So, like just to get it started, what's a memory that you have with your father that's like your favorite?
Oh yeah,
memory with your father.
Yeah. So my dad, phenomenal dad, but I didn't have very long with him. He died when I was 13. So my memories are all childhood memories with my dad. And so my dad loved being outside, and so one of his favorite things to do was work in the garden. And it was like an all-year thing. We would grow tons of vegetables and, you know, canned vegetables and do all that sort of stuff. But my dad, it would start in the fall. We would go around our neighborhood in my dad's Pinto or his Honda Civic hatchback with the massage bead covers on the seats because they were ripped all up.
Right.
And so we would go around our neighborhood looking for bags of leaves in the fall. And so we'd throw those bags of leaves into the Honda Civic hatchback. Then we'd bring those back. He'd put them in. They'd compost all, you know, fall and winter long. They'd be ready for spring. Mm. He'd be out there tilling. And so, yeah, favorite memories are me when I was in much better shape. Shirt off with my dad, rocking the 80s sweatband. You know what I mean? Like, that's like to make sure, like, I love it. Farmer tan going on.
Get that picture in your mind.
The tiller going. I love it. Yeah, it was great. Great memories with my dad doing that. What about you, man?
Dude, okay, so my dad, me and my brother and my sister would go, and we would play football with my dad on Sundays, right? And so one of the things that I remember was that we always played football with a Washington Redskins football, and it always was like odd to me that we played with a Washington Redskins football, and it was like, why did we have that? Because my dad was a Cowboys fan, and then we liked the Panthers, and I was always just kind of like, man, we got this Redskins football. I don't know if dad's like converting, like the Cowboys and the Skins hate each other. So it wasn't until like literally like a few years ago, like I'm a grown man, and like this is my whole childhood, and my dad was like, yeah, with that Washington Redskins football, and we're reminiscing, and I'm like, yeah. He goes, you know why we got that football, son? And I said, why? And he said, because it was the cheapest one. Literally, it was just on sale. Like, that's the
nobody wanted the Washington football.
No one wanted it, but my dad said, you know what? It's going to serve the purpose that we need it for, football on Sundays.
That's awesome.
All right, so we did start, I believe in God the Father Almighty. Pastor David, for someone that maybe wasn't at the message, could you just do a really quick recap of what was talked about?
Yeah, so we looked at a few different passages from Psalm 121, Psalm 146, and Acts chapter 17. Yep. And in that, just sort of kind of conveying the idea that we have a God who's almighty. Just the reality of that. I think so many times we get caught up in trying to make our own lives. Mm. We forget about the sovereignty of God. We forget about the power of God. Yeah. And just from that idea of he's El Shaddai, he's God, all-powerful, almighty. There's no limits to his power and his authority. And that shows itself in creation. He's the maker of heaven and earth. He's the God who is able to speak, and then something exists that never existed before.
Yeah.
But then at the same time, he's not just all-powerful. He's not just God almighty. He's God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. And I think there's a huge thing that separates Christianity from every other world religion in that, right? You know, every other world religion, it's you're going to work your way into pleasing a God that will maybe show you favor.
Right.
And Christianity is totally different. It's about God, almighty, all-powerful, maker of everything, but who chose to adopt us as his children, that he wants that personal relationship as father with us. Mm. And so the reality of that he's both, he's almighty, but he's also father. That's huge.
It's so cool that that's like the first line of the creed, and just kind of like maybe a brief history, if you don't mind. Just what exactly is the creed? Why is it something that's important? I know you touched on it a little bit in your message, but what gives this creed like credence, for lack of a better word?
Yeah. So you know, this creed, I think when you see Jesus's prayer in John chapter 17 before he goes to the cross the next morning. He says, Father, make my people one in the same way that you and I are one, the Spirit's one. Everybody who comes after me that believes in me, make them one, right? And Jesus wanted this unity in the body of Christ where there was a oneness. And, you know, 50,000 denominations later, I think there's a lot of division in the body of Christ. But this creed is so old. We call it the Apostles' Creed. Mm-hmm. Some scholars say that each of the 12 apostles had a piece in writing each of the 12 parts of it.
That's cool.
We don't know for sure, but we know this dates back more than 1,700 years.
Yeah.
This creed comes from people who were discipled by the people that were with Jesus, right? And so, you know, it was something that united people as believers across, you know, Jews, Gentiles, from different places. It didn't matter if you were in Greece or if you were in Turkey or if you were in Africa. Like all of the followers of Jesus believed more than what was in this creed, but nobody who followed Jesus believed less.
That's so
it was a unifier. So people would use it as a statement of faith. They would use it as a creed to state before baptism to say, I believe, not just I believe it, but we all believe this together.
Right.
And so, you know, I think in our culture right now that's so divided, it's so important as believers to focus on the one who unites us.
Right.
And so as we focus in on these truths from Scripture about who God is and what we believe about Him and the church and the Scriptures and all of that, I think it's very unifying.
Yeah.
Because we can say, these are the same things that they believed 1,700 years ago. These are the same things that people in multiple denominations, we all say these are the essential truths of the gospel.
Yeah.
And we believe them.
And it's so cool that it like unifies us. And we were talking the other day just about how cool it is that it's literally like originated from the guys that knew the guys that knew the guys that knew Jesus.
Right.
Like if I knew a guy that knew a guy that knew a guy, that knew somebody that played for the Panthers,
right.
I'd be telling everybody, like, hey, look, here's his phone number. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like I would like, that would be my claim to fame. Like, I'm three people removed from a guy that plays on Sundays, right?
Seven degrees of Kevin Bacon. Is that like that game? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So, actually, that one probably predates me. I don't even know. Or I just don't play board games.
Come on. You're making me feel old now. Okay.
Oh, man. But that's so cool. It comes from these people, so we can trust it, but it also is something that unifies us. And so, you know, I just told Pastor David a few seconds before we started, but I actually just rebought The Knowledge of the Holy, which is written by A.W. Tozer. And you know, any conversation about like baseline theology, you know, Tozer needs to be involved at some level. He's just, you know, super smart. But he writes some stuff that even mere mortals can understand. And so I found this quote, and this is a proper way to start it off. And it's just, Tozer writes, without a doubt, the mightiest thought the mind can entertain is the thought of God.
Mm.
And the weightiest word in any language is its word for God.
Yeah.
And so, Pastor David, could you explain that to the folks at home that are like me that have no clue what that just meant, but know it's good somewhere deep down inside?
Yeah. Anytime I read Tozer, man, I realize how not smart I am, how unsmart I am. That's not even a word. But no, I love this quote because what he's meaning is that the things that you think about God are the highest things that you can think.
Hmm.
And because they impact every area of your life, right? If you believe that there's no God, that's going to impact every major question you have about life. Who am I? What's my purpose? What's the goal of the world? What's the meaning of life, right? And so how you answer the question of who is God impacts every other question about life. And so your highest thoughts about God answer everything else. And so when you talk about God being God Almighty, the Father, God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, instantly if your thought process is, well, he's the God of the Bible. Yeah. He's the God the Bible describes as almighty, all-powerful. There's no God that comes close to him. Yeah. He's the God over every kingdom, every nation, every time period. The God over every people group. He's the God almighty, and he's the maker of heaven and earth. Then that starts to answer some questions of, well, who is God? Yeah. Who am I? What's the meaning of life? What's the purpose of life? You have to start with answering that question. I think that's what Tozer's saying.
Yeah, and you start off with answering that question. And like you said, you totally get way more questions because there are more layers you peel back. You start to see that it just kind of unravels more questions as you keep getting deeper because, okay, God is this. So that means that whenever it says something like in the creed and what Jesus says in the Lord's Prayer, our Father or God the Father Almighty, it starts there. You know, and it's like God is this almighty creator who has power, who's omnipotent, who's holy, who's omniscient, all of these things. But he's also like a father. Like, I mean, that kind of just blows my mind.
Yeah. When, you know, I do love that you brought that up because there's this, I think there's a reason why the writers of the creed started with God as almighty and also as father. Mm. And then when Jesus is teaching his disciples to pray, He talks to them in a way to say, you start out by saying, our Father, right? Not just my Father, not just your Father, our Father. There's a collective that's a part of that. He's our Father. But I think even that was a huge new concept, right? Like, if you look all over the world, people didn't think of God as Father, right? Like, maybe they thought of him as mighty. Or false gods as mighty, like, oh, there's the God of the thunder, or God of fertility, or God of... They're powerful over a particular place or particular topic. Mm. But to think of God as there's one God who's almighty over everything, but then he's also one that you can have the privilege of calling our Father. That's huge. So talk a little bit about that, Garrett. What do you think there's some correlation there why the Apostles' Creed writers start out with Father and then Jesus talks about... in that way?
Indeed. It is actually so cool that that's what God wanted us to know, right? Yeah. Because Jesus is God. Like, I know that's like a whole mind-blowing thing, but he is God, right? But that's, I don't want to jump ahead a couple of weeks, but he says, our Father, right? And so he starts it off by saying, no, this God that was, and again, he's speaking predominantly to Israelites or Hebrews at the time, people that would have known Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who knew the God that did things like bring the people of Israel out of Egypt, who called Abraham out of Ur, who set up the nation, who did these mighty and powerful things, right? But was always kind of distant, right? Mm. Keep in mind, like whenever the temple was created, Moses said, okay, here's the deal. Only the Levites can even touch the stuff.
Yeah.
Right? Everybody else has this outer court.
Yeah.
Then there's this inner court. Then there's the holy place. Then there's the most holy place. It's like there's four levels of separation between you and God.
Yeah.
And only one guy in a whole nation could go in one time out of the whole year to be in the presence of God. So that's how they saw God.
Yeah.
And I feel like all the other religions that you just said, I've had conversations with people that are like, Hindu and just believe some different stuff. Obviously Muslims, another one in Jewish faith, and having conversations about these people or with these people about their relationship with God predominantly, it seems almost as if God is this distant being. Mm. But then Jesus comes speaking to the crowd that's four levels of separation away from God, and that's if they're even good at practicing the religion.
Yeah.
And he says, when you pray, right, when you talk to this God, start like this, our Father in heaven.
That's huge.
And I mean, I don't know if we want to jump off the cliff and start talking about like the Aramaic word for Father, which Jesus taught in was Abba.
Yeah.
And it was kind of like, just Dad, you know? Like
Daddy.
Which is weird.
Yeah.
And
no, I know you're a brand new dad, right?
Yeah, I am
so
a brand new dad.
Brand new dad. Your baby is how old? How old is he?
He'll be, so depending on what day of the week you're watching this video, he could be 2 months old.
Watch
on that day.
Out.
On Tuesday, the February the 8th, baby.
Junior. I love it.
Junior.
So, I mean, you know, I think about this deal. He can only cry. He can't call out your name yet, right? But he can only cry. And then he doesn't really want you. He wants your wife anyway. But you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, but in this deal, like you think about, like there's such a personal in that word, Abba, right? And so for the writers of the creed to sort of balance this and say, he's God Almighty.
Yeah.
He's the Almighty, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-seeing, all-creative. He's El Shaddai, God Almighty. He's Elohim, the creator and judge over everything, the maker of heaven and earth. Right. But you can call that God Dad. Daddy. Like, to be so personal, that's huge.
It will blow your mind. If you really want to take a deep dive, when you start your Bible study, wherever you are, it's only February, so maybe you're in Exodus, I don't know. Depending on how fast you're reading through it, you might be in Leviticus or Numbers, reading every word, right?
Yeah, there you go.
But it's cool if you just start looking at how God chooses to reveal himself to the people that know him the best, and it gets a little bit more personal each time.
Yeah.
But it is crazy that it goes to Jesus, and then it's like the Word made flesh, and he introduces God as Dad.
Yeah. Yeah, that's huge. That's huge.
So cool. But then, of course, I actually read an article yesterday, and we haven't talked about this, so I'm just going to surprise you here.
Yeah, go for it.
Catch you off your heels.
I love it.
Trying to, at least. I actually read an article the other day that said, like, you know, whenever we call God Dad, Daddy, he's like, is that Aramaic word? Like, do we at some point rob God of that majesty? See, I don't know that I necessarily agree with that.
Yeah.
Because I think that it's both. Because if you put God in a box, keep going with the Tozer thing, he becomes less than God at some point. But it is kind of odd that he can be Dad.
Yeah.
At the same time as Almighty.
Yeah.
And I think that I don't even know, man. What does it mean for God to be Almighty as well as Dad at the same time?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think that the only way he can be almighty and all-powerful and also Dad at the same time, we have to get later in the creed and talk about how Jesus made that possible, right? Because the holiness of God demands a punishment, right? The majesty, the huge grandeur of God, but because of what Jesus did, he's able to also be this Father. I think you're right. Most people try to put God in one of two boxes, right? And so they either think of him as Father, but like a weak Father.
Right.
Like this heavenly grandfather in the sky with amnesia, like the man upstairs, right? Who's like, oh, he just loves everybody. And, you know, he just forgets about sin and, you know, all this stuff. Because, he's just such a good dad. He would never, you know, punish anybody, right?
Yeah.
Or people look at God as Almighty, like this all-powerful judge who's ready to strike you down and doesn't have this lovingness of a father.
Right.
And so, but I think that's the beauty of Scripture is that it shows these both. In Psalm 121, he talks about, you know, my eyes look up to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth. He doesn't slumber or sleep, right? And so, like, there's this element of always remember you can run to God as Father,
right?
But your Father is all-powerful, right? It's I think there's things like that you don't understand about your dad when you're little. Right, you know what I mean? Like then as you grow up, there's things that's like, oh, I understand who my dad is and was and all the other pieces of that. And I think there's Christians that they try to look at God from one aspect and they just sort of pigeonhole him there. But I think Scripture really tells us we should see both. We should see both about who God is, that we can always come to him as Father because of Jesus.
Mm.
But at the same time, we have a Father who's all powerful.
That's good, and that really does bring it full circle.
Yeah,
but I think at the same time, it's also probably hard for some people to think of God as one or as both at the same simultaneously. Like we want to do like one or the other. Like God's either Almighty, and I kind of remember like the journey that was for me. Right, so I got saved whenever I was 18 in high school, and then, as I discovered like who God was, it was more God was Almighty, right?
Yeah.
God was holy. Like who was I to even come into God's presence? And I remember there was a lot of tremendous benefit in that.
Sure.
I don't know if it was just because, you know, I didn't have the best of relationships with my dad, but it was always hard to picture God as Father. But whenever I got that reality, then it was God is also my father. Mm. But then I might have leaned a little bit too much into the father side and forgot how powerful God was. Yeah. You know, when you're praying, you're like talking to God, but you forget that he's all powerful.
Yeah.
I don't know. Kind of talk about, like, I think that a lot of people are probably in that same boat that I was, you know, back and forth, like between God is both at the same time.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, just open
I think,
it up.
I think part of it, some of that is seasons of life, right? Yeah. Like, and I think, you know, in the same way that you said, God chose to reveal himself to the Israelites at different places throughout their journey of this is how you're going to see me. And I think there are times where in our lives, we need the comfort of the Father.
Yeah.
And then there's other times where we need to see the power of Almighty God. And so, you know, I mean, I think he is both. He's both all at the same time and so much more, you know. But I think part of it, too, is to keep in mind this idea of he wants the closeness and the personal of a father. But he also wants you to remember his capabilities as the Almighty. So as you come to him with your worries, as you come to him with your fears, as you come to him as a loving father, he welcomes you in because he wants you to be close to him. He wants a great relationship with all of his children.
Yeah.
But then at the same time, he doesn't ever want his kids to think of him in an impotent way. There's nothing he can't do, right? Like there's, I don't know if preschool parents, like, yeah, you, my God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do for you. You know what I mean? Like, we sang that song a million times with our kids as they were growing up. But I think it's one of those deals. It's he wants this constant reminder of his power, but also how personal he is.
He's powerful, and he's also personal at the same time.
Yeah.
And it's crazy. And whenever I think about, like, just how these guys wrote the creed, right?
Yeah.
Which you said was used at baptisms. It was derivative from the people that knew Jesus, you know? And so I could see them, you know, just kind of like writing it down and just thinking, getting together and just saying, I believe in, and then they pause. Okay, what do we believe in, right? And they say, God, who is God, right?
Yeah.
Who is he? He's the Father. He's that personal God, because we know Jesus taught us we could come to him as Father. Ask the Father anything in my name and it shall be done, right? Like, come to him.
Yeah.
He's the one that's our Father. He unites us all, right? And then he's Almighty at the same time. And he's the creator of heaven and earth. Like, he's still the God that we always knew he was. But now we have this access to him through Jesus.
Yeah, that's so good.
That's just, I mean, insane.
Yeah.
So how, if somebody's struggling with maybe God being powerful, and you see God as powerful, and trust me, I know where you are if that's you, and I also know how you feel if you're like, God is just personal, right?
Yeah.
Like, you fail to see God's power, but if you're in that boat, if someone's in that boat that's watching, getting ready to go into a discussion, like powerful and personal at the same time, how would you give advice to somebody that sees God as one or the other, but not both at the same time predominantly?
Yeah, I mean, I think my best piece of advice would be to ask God to show you himself, right? Like, I think there's a precedent for that of believers in the Bible saying, show us the reality of who you are. Because, like Tozer said, everything else in life stems off of what you believe about who God is, right? And so, Lord, I don't want to miss aspects of your character.
Yeah.
I don't want to miss your power and your might. Like, I don't want to walk around feeling defeated and feel like, oh, I got this close personal father, but he's not able to do things. Like, that misses out on who God is.
But
I also don't want to walk around like thinking God's going to strike me down with a lightning bolt all the time because he's all powerful and almighty. And if I mess up, then woo, you better watch out, because that's not the reality of Scripture either.
Yeah.
All of God's righteous anger was poured out on Jesus in our place. And so he's totally satisfied. So we can come to him as Father, but as an all-powerful Father.
Yeah.
And so I would just say this week, maybe just spend a little bit of time talking to God, saying, God, am I missing a part of who you are? Because I want to experience the fullness of who you are as God, the Father, Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Yeah, absolutely. And I really, like, I totally echo that point. Pastor David just kind of said it, like, just pray about it. God's good.
Yeah.
He wants to show you himself, like, that. And that's the cool thing.
Yeah.
All right. So as we go into small groups, what do you want everybody watching to know? How can they get involved?
Yeah.
What should they know transition?
So we have community groups that meet almost every night of the week. Okay. We have options to meet in person. We also have options to meet virtually. Like if you're not getting together with people outside of your house right now, we totally understand that too.
Yeah.
So there's e-groups, ones that will be available. One's going to be around lunchtime on Wednesdays. Yep. There's also groups at night that are virtual. There's groups that meet in person all over our area. Yep. And so if you've been watching this, you've been joining us on the Premiere feature, and you've enjoyed it, listen, why don't you just type in the chat right now? We'd love to know what some of your favorite memories were with your dad. That was our first question. But if you're interested in connecting deeper so that you can talk through, especially during this series, it's a 5-week series, you want to talk with other people, get to build some relationships, whether that's in person or virtually, then just put message me as a comment right now, either on YouTube or Facebook.
Yeah.
And one of our community group leaders will reach out to you, talk to you about your situation, what night of the week works best for you, and we'll make sure we get you in a group that works for you.
And if they don't know what time services are on Sundays coming into week two, what times are we live?
9 and 11. 9 and 11. So in person or on YouTube or Facebook live stream, we'd love to see you there for week two of the Creed.
All right. Well, that wraps up our discussion this week. We're doing another one next week, and we can't wait to see you then.